Good morning. It is said in God's word, we are to enter into his courts with thanksgiving and into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Let us praise the Lord today. The Lord is worthy of all our praise. What a friend we have in Jesus. All of our griefs to bear. Our reading this morning is lifted from Hebrews, the 10th chapter, verses 19 through 22 from the King James Version. And it reads in this fashion. Having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way, which he hath consecrated for us through the veil, that is to say, his flesh, and in having an high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart and full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. The word of the Lord.
Here.
good, and his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endures to all generations. Bow your heads with me, church. Father God in heaven, as we enter into this glad time of worship, we call on your holy name. Father, we reverence you. We adore you. We exalt you on this wonderful day of worship. Father, we have come here. And we have come here with the grand expectation of meeting up with you in something called worship. So, Father, I pray that you will accept our worship and accept us in worship. Bless now, I pray thee, Heavenly Father, that we might experience you in a powerful way, that it will move us, Master, and strengthen us, that we will know that we did worship you this day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. And amen. We greet all of you in the matchless and marvelous name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And to all of our visitors and guests this morning, good morning. God bless you one and all. Let's give God the praise this morning. I think that'll help us a little bit, just to give God the praise. That's why we're here this morning. He ought to be our focus. Am I right? Amen. A wonderful, wonderful, wonderful Palm Sunday to everyone, where Jesus moved us from a sense of tragedy and sin to a triumph in him. And we need to always be found giving him the praise. Amen. Palm Sunday. Church, God is our central focus every time we meet up together in worship. And in order to maintain that focus, we will only make reference to cards. They will not be read. You need to give the card to your cards of thanks or whatever to the clerk and our missionary president, our clerk, Sister Drunetta Young, our missionary president, Sister Ella Owens, and they will make sure that they make mention of that to me so that I can make mention of that to the congregation. They will be posted on the bulletin board in the education building as per usual. And if there are any deaths or illnesses or anything like that, I will only make reference to it so we can keep our focus on the Lord, and that you can call the church number 421-5288 and get all the necessary details and information you desire about that, as much as we will have it. Amen? Yes, sir. Amen. We don't always get the information right away, but such as we have, we will share that with you as that individual or family allows us to do it. Does that make sense? Yes, sir. So we want to keep our focus on the Lord. So all that kind of thing, the reading of cards and giving out details for announcements, that will only be referenced and not be given in detail. We do have cards, or have received cards, from the Davis family. Be mindful of that. They thank you for your support, and also the Mayo family and also the McInnes family. Pray for them and keep them lifted up in your prayers. Pray, pray, pray. Again, if you need to call, the church number is 421-5288, area code 314, 421-5288. And all that necessary information, details, and whatever else will be given to you. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. And having said those things, I'm going to ask you to bow your heads with me again as we enter into another time of prayer, and this is the altar prayer. If we were not in this pandemic, we would come around the altar. We would hold hands. We would pray. As I pray aloud, I invite you to pray silently within yourselves. Father in heaven, we love you. We love you, Father, because you first loved us. While we were yet in our sins, you sent Jesus to die for us. For you so loved the world that you gave him, and we are thankful. We're thankful for the gift of salvation that is known only in him. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for life and the health and strength of life such as you afford us. Father, we recognize and realize that you got us up this morning and you started every one of us on our way. We're thankful, Father, that you have given us the presence of mind to find our way here in this public and corporate form of worship. Oh, Heavenly Father, thank you for Jesus. Thank you for his death upon the cross. Thank you for his burial, proving his death. Thank you, O Heavenly Father, for his grand resurrection. Thank you for your Holy Spirit, that as your Son did ascend on high and is now at your right hand in glory, you sent him that he might be that comforter for us, another paraclete. Thank you for your Holy Spirit. Father, I pray that you will just have mercy on all of us. Forgive us of our horrible and heinous sins. For certainly we have sinned against you, and we have sinned against our fellow man. We've sinned in thought. We have sinned in deed. We have sinned in speech. So, Father, we ask that you forgive us and show us your mercy today, not holding those wrong things against us, but removing them as far from us as the east is from the west, and throwing them over into the sea of forgetfulness and remembering them no more. Oh, Heavenly Father, we call on your holy name today, for we feel oftentimes the burden of our sin. But Father, we know that you're able to lift that burden from us because of the shed blood of Jesus Christ, because of his redemptive work upon the cross. Thank you, Father. Father, I pray for the sick and the shut in among us. Father, I pray for Mother Beverly Primus. Lord, she desires prayer. Father, she desires your comfort and your consolation. And Father, we're thankful, for we have had a favorable report. And we pray your blessing continually upon her and her family. Father, bless Tina, who we communicated with this morning. Father, we don't inform you. You already know. Father, as you are here with us, you're there with her. Lord, bless, Lord, strengthen today, as only you can. We're trusting you, Father, and we have a confident expectation of favorable things there as well. Father, bless all of our sick and bless all of our shut in. Bless those who are grieving, for they miss their loved ones. A void has been created where their life once stood. And Father, we know that you know how to fill every void. And so we ask of you right now, dear Master, fill those voids with your loving kindness. Feel those voids, Father, with your comfort. Feel those voids, O Heavenly Father, with your consolation. Feel those voids, O Heavenly Father. Father, bless these who have appeared here this morning. For they have come here, Father, with the express purpose in mind to worship you and to worship you only, to give you high praise in this sanctified and sacred space. Lord God, I pray that you will allow us and help us to enter into our own being and come face to face with you, as it were, and worship you, to kiss your face, to do obeisance before you today. Lord God, we have a gnawing need to worship you. Father, I pray that there be no hindrances, but Father, we can freely come to you. Those matters that are upon us and in us, Father, I pray that they will be melted away, that we can easily access your throne of grace on this day that you have made. Father, we have purpose to rejoice and to be glad in it. For Father, we know that our hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and his righteousness. Father, thank you for the shed blood of Jesus Christ. Father, we pray for peace among us. We pray for understanding between us. Father, help us to realize that we have this commonality, and he is Jesus Christ. And Father, allow us to have a love that runs from heart to heart and breast to breast. Father, let us embrace one another with a love, Father, a love that proves that we are Christians. Oh, dear Lord, the world is in such a mess. But Father, we know that you are still in absolute control. We know that you are sovereign, and your sovereign grace is wherever you are, and you are everywhere. And we pray, oh, Heavenly Father, that there'll be men there who will access your grace, and that your grace, oh, Heavenly Father, will be known in those places, in those situations, and under those circumstances. Not only all over the world, but in this nation. Not only in this nation, but in this state, and not only in this state, but in this city, and not only in this city, but in this immediate community. Lord God, I pray that this church can be that balm that can be applied to the matters of the human condition. Let this church be a beacon light in the dark situations in this community. Oh, Heavenly Father, help us to stand up and stand out for you, that men and women, boys and girls will realize that there's an alternative to the way that they're going. That there'll be a cessation of gun violence. Father, that there'll not be trouble in the land as before. But Father, that there'll be hope, real hope, favorable and confident expectation that you are able to do anything but fail. Oh Lord, our Lord, how excellent is your name in all the earth. Bless the tithe, the offering, and the pledge, and those who have attended to it. Oh Heavenly Father, bless today. Bless all over the sanctuary. Bless those who are viewing virtually. Bless this church altogether. Help us to become more united and be as one. And being so close, one cannot fall for the other. Oh Lord, our Lord, How excellent is your name in all the earth. Bless us with health and strength and a general sense of well-being. For we all need you for one thing or another. And as the psalmist said, you are our shepherd. And with you, we have everything we need. And we give you the praise, Lord, and say hallelujah to your glorious name. In Jesus' name, we say amen, amen, amen. God bless you, church. And now our inspirational song, period. And we pray that you be so inspired by the singing. Thank you. How many of you know that the Lord is good? Is he good? His goodness means that he has done something to benefit you. And God is doing something to benefit us all the time. And when God does it, it's matchless. No one can benefit us. No one can be good to us like our Heavenly Father. Am I right about it? Amen. You do know that this is Palm Sunday, don't you? Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. And Palm Sunday always deals with hope and celebration. And so we have the hope. Where's the celebration? Let's celebrate the Lord today. Amen. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. God is good, church. And his mercy is everlasting. and his truth endures to all generations. Oh, blessed be the name of our God. Father in heaven, we have come to the portion of this service that is pregnant with preaching. Father, your word must be delivered today. So, Father, I pray that you take me and use me as an instrument of your holy will, that your will be done today. Father, I pray that you will speak a word into this atmosphere of worship. Speak a word into our hearts, into our lives. Speak a word, O Heavenly Father, over our situations and circumstances of life. Father, that we might have hope, that we might have this confident expectation that everything is certainly all right. Father, I pray that the words of my mouth, as well as the meditations of my heart, be found acceptable in thy sight, my Lord, my strength, my Redeemer. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 In view of the overwhelming evidence of man's inhumanity to man and the blatant disregard for God, one can easily see the decline and devaluation of morality. The source of this divesting decline and devaluation is the spiritually dead state of all mankind. For all have sinned and have come short of the glory of God, Romans 3:23. And the cause of this spiritual death is sin. And sin literally means the missing of the standardized mark of righteousness that God set for mankind. In the original state, in the Garden of Eden, mankind, represented in Adam and Eve, disobeyed the command of God, thus missing the mark. That disobedient spirit is inherently resident in all, rendering us spiritually dead, separated from God, the author of all life. The world, this human race, outside of God's grace, is spiritually dead, without hope. But the good news is, God gives us new life by grace through something called faith, which sets the believer on the course of hope. And it is a living hope. If you were to go with me now, church, go with me to 1 Peter. 1 Peter, the first chapter. Beginning to read at the third verse and through the fifth of the King James Version, with emphasis on verses 3 and 5. And these words are given. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy hath begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled, and that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you, who are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. Verse 3, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy hath begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Verse 5, who are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. And in your standing and in your hearing, the title of this message is simply, A Living Hope in a Dead World. A Living Hope in a Dead World. If you have the King James Version, it might say lively hope, but more literally translated and understood, it's living hope. A living hope in a dead world. We are so accustomed to this world that we think it's just all right. But I'm here to tell somebody that this world is dead before God without Christ. Those of us who are believers today, those of us who have been born again, those of us who are blood bought, we have a living hope. Yet we reside in a dead world. Is anybody listening to me this morning? I know we put a lot of stock in this world. We put a lot of stock in this life. But if we were to compare the things of this world over against the Word of God, we'd see how terrible of a shape this world is in. A living hope in a dead world. Now, the Christian church observance of Palm Sunday signifies a sense of hope and celebration. The hope that was carried by the celebratory Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna, or translated, save, we pray, in the highest. As the crowd converged and continued along the garments and branches covered road to Jerusalem. That hope was the favorable and confident expectation that Jesus was the Christ. As Jesus emerged traveled down that road from Bethphage, or some say Bethphage, to Jerusalem. A crowd began to gather. And as he rode along on that donkey, they began to shout, Hosanna, Hosanna. And so they had this expectation that he was the Christ. Having hope, trusting God, things would be better. The people had and held that hope, and they held and had that hope in the backdrop of Roman governmental oppression and suppression, believing Jesus would free them from Roman authority and reestablish the Davidic kingdom. But the hope Jesus would instill is far grander than the freedom from man's inhumanity to man. Brothers and sisters, the hope the Christian has is based upon the excellent and eternal life of Jesus Christ. The hope the Christian has is based upon the excellent and eternal life of Jesus Christ. Just in a nutshell, no Jesus, no hope. If you don't have Jesus, you have a false hope. You have a limited hope. You have a hope that will let you down every time. But this same Jesus, who was dead and is now alive, if you have hope in Jesus, it is a living hope, because Jesus is alive. I don't care what the world may say. I don't care what the scoffers may do and say. I'm here standing on the promises of God. And I have a hope. It's not a wish. It is a confident expectation about Jesus Christ. Hallelujah, somebody. And my eternal life. I have eternal life now, but one day I'm going to have eternal life in its fullness. Never to die again in a new heaven. Hallelujah, somebody. I'm here to tell you that if somebody does not have Jesus, they don't have real hope. Every time you turn around, they got tears in their eyes about one thing or another, all because they stand as hopeless individuals. But my hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and his righteousness. And I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ, the solid rock I stand. All other ground is nothing but sinking sand. I've tried other measures, and I'm here to tell you that they just don't work. I'm a student of world religions, and I have found out that the only one that works for me is the Christian religion. It is Jesus Christ and Jesus alone. It's Jesus for me. I don't care what it is for you, but I suggest that you try him for yourself. The hope the Christian has is based upon the excellent and eternal life of Jesus Christ. First is that the certainty of salvation is grounded by the life of Jesus Christ. The certainty of salvation is grounded by the life of Jesus Christ, verse 3. Secondly, the security of salvation is guarded by God in the life of Jesus Christ, verse 5. The security of salvation is guarded by God in the life of Jesus Christ. The certainty of salvation is guaranteed by the life of Jesus Christ. Verse 3, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy hath begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. The certainty of salvation is guaranteed by God, guaranteed by the life of Jesus Christ. He was dead, but now he is alive, and he's alive forevermore. Hallelujah, somebody. Praise the name of the Lord. I wonder how many saints I have in the house today that believe that Jesus is alive. Yes, he died, but all men die. But Jesus arose from the dead. He arose from the dead with all power in heaven and earth, all authority in heaven and earth in his hands. And it does not matter what may come upon you and what may come against you. Jesus is more than the world because he has overcome the world. Praise the name of the Lord. The Apostle Peter, he addressed this epistle, this letter, to the churches of Asia Minor that were being persecuted just because they were Christians. I moan and cry sometimes because people bother me so much. But the Holy Spirit had to remind me that they bother you because you're a Christian and you're standing on the promises of God. And I tell you, we have an adversary, and he is the devil. Am I talking to anybody? And he's trying to get you off square one and get you back to where you used to be and make you act outside of your Christian character. Hallelujah, somebody. Praise the name of the Lord. But these of the dispersed exiles were being persecuted just because they were Christians. And as they were persecuted, they were going here and there. And for you Bible students and you inquisitive minds who are sitting here this morning, every time you get persecuted, it spreads you somewhere else. And guess what? Wherever you go, you got Jesus with you. And wherever you are, you can't help but tell them that I'm only standing here today because Jesus is on my side. Hallelujah, somebody. So when trouble comes into your life, it's a mechanism that spreads the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so as they were being spread here and there all over Asia Minor, they were telling somebody about their living Lord, living the Christian life in a world that goes counter to Christian life principles, can be a persecuting predicament, which could cause one to lose heart. You could faint along your Christian journey. Hallelujah, somebody. Because of the many, many waves of persecuting predicaments that God allows to come into your life. And God allows them to come into your life because they come to only make you strong. If God would only let you know good, hallelujah, somebody, and not for you to suffer wrong and hurt and harm, God would do you a disservice. Because every time this trouble comes into your life, you know how to go down on your knees and reinforce your relationship with the Lord and call on him who is merciful and will help you in your persecuting predicament. Peter encouraged those saints to know and remember that they were living a spiritually regenerated life. He had to remind them that they had been born again. He says to them, which according to his abundant mercy hath begotten us again. That means they were born again. Born again to new possibilities. Born again to new promises. Born again to new purpose. Hallelujah, somebody. Some of you are sitting here on some worn out possibilities, and you just think as if there are no more possibilities for you. I remember after my children had become good and grown, I thought that life of children in my life was gone until my grandson came, and the possibility of fresh new life shone again in my life. I'm here to tell you that your possibility might be worn out. Your possibility may have gone dark. But I'm here to tell you that if you're born again, blood bought child of God, you got new possibilities and new promises. Promises that have been broken. Promises that have failed you. Promises. God has a new promise, and God will never leave you. God will never forsake you. God never lies. God cannot lie. God promises, and we have hope because he promised, and we have new purpose. Life, this old life that we used to live, has its old purposes. But I'm here to tell you that you ought to reach out for your new purpose in Jesus Christ. I've heard people say that folk make them lose their purposes. There's no such thing. If God has a purpose for you, nobody can take it, and nobody can make you lose it. Only you. Hallelujah, somebody. I got a new purpose in life. I'm going to walk my purpose. I'm going to sing my purpose. I'm going to preach my purpose. I'm going to teach my purpose. I'm going to visit the sick my purpose. I'm going to tell somebody about Jesus. That's my purpose. I got a new purpose in life, to love my enemy. I got a new purpose in life, to go the extra mile. I got a new purpose. And it's the life worth living, I want to tell you, because of God's assured guarantee. Hallelujah, somebody. Brothers and sisters, the hope of your new life is fixed and settled in the payment of your sin debt by the precious life of Jesus Christ. All of us owed a debt. For the wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Jesus came and he paid a debt that we could not pay, and a debt he didn't owe. Jesus stepped up and stepped forward in the ranks of humanity that our sin debt might be paid. As long as I owed my debt, I couldn't have a relationship with my Creator. I couldn't have a relationship with my now Heavenly Father if I still owed a debt. Am I right about it? If you owed something and you went to a lending institution and you tried to get some more money, they might just chase you away because they'll tell you you still owe a debt. Am I right about it? And if you can't pay this debt, what makes me think that you can pay another debt? Am I right about it? But a hallelujah, somebody. Jesus has paid my debt so I can keep going to God over and over and over and over again. God will forgive you of your debt because of Jesus Christ. Because of his precious life. I went to visit a member who was in the hospital the other day. And I went to the information desk and they asked for a picture ID. You know me, I wanted to ask what for, but I just said, okay. And a stick-on badge was made that stated who I was and proved who I was by the photo. Your hope, brothers and sisters, ought to look just like Jesus. Your hope is a badge, hallelujah, that they made from the photo of Jesus Christ. And your hope ought to look just like Jesus. When men ask you, why do you yet hope? You ought to tell them, it's Jesus. And they might ask you why, Jesus, but tell them because Jesus died for me. Well, all men die, they might say, but my Jesus, tell them that your Jesus got up again on that third day morning. And say, how do you know he lives? Tell him he lives. He lives because he lives inside of me. And there's no doubt this morning that Jesus lives. Your living hope certifies your salvation. If you go about in this life with no hope, no one can truly know that you will have been born again. Because your hope says you expect everything the Bible says to be yours. Your hope says that you expect that Jesus will come back one of these old days. Your hope says that you can talk to God anytime you want to. Your hope says that your God will take care of you. Your hope says all these things and so much more. Your living hope certifies your salvation. When trials and tribulations come, and they do come, you still have hope. When the world sees you wearing your badge of hope, they will know that you are living a life of expectation of Christ. When the storms of life are raging, you still have hope. Because your life ought to be a living praise for Jesus Christ. Every time somebody sees you, they don't have to hear you say, praise the Lord. They ought to see you living, praise the Lord. Hallelujah, somebody. Well, how can you live like you're praising the Lord when you live just like Jesus? Hallelujah, somebody. When they smack you on one cheek, turn to them the other. Forgive those who despitefully use you. Give water to those who do you wrong. Am I right about it? Live a life of praise for Jesus Christ. For Jesus came and he gave his life for us. How are we to be toward our fellow man? We ought to love them and love them unconditionally. Not because of, but in spite of how they treat you. Not only that, the security of salvation is guarded by God in the life of Jesus Christ. The security of salvation is guarded by God in the life of Jesus Christ. Verse 5 tells us, who are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. Hallelujah, somebody. Ready to be revealed in the last time suggests that the fullness of your salvation will be manifested and you will live throughout ceaseless ages, if I can dare to measure eternity. Eternity is time without end. Eternity is without measured duration. It's just forever. Hallelujah, somebody. We're going to a place where we'll never grow old. Every year that ticks away in my life, I slow down just a little bit more. And my hair is getting more and more gray and heading toward white. Hallelujah, somebody. I got creaks in my knees, and sometimes my back is bothering me. Got arthritis in my hand from time to time. I'm moving slower and slower. But I'm going to a land where I'll never grow old. Hallelujah, somebody. I'll never get sick. I'll be there forevermore. I ought to have at least two or three folk there with me that don't mind praising God. Hallelujah, for what's in store for all of us. All of us are aging. Hallelujah, somebody. But the security of salvation is guarded by God in the life of Jesus Christ. The Apostle Peter informed those exiled and persecuted saints of Asia Minor that their hope was kept or guarded by God's sustaining power. Who Jesus you need to know is real. What Jesus did is real. And it cannot be undone. No matter what men may say, no matter what scoffers may say, Jesus is real today. Hallelujah, somebody. What Jesus did is real today. And it cannot be undone. And guess what? I'm glad that it can't be undone. My hope is based on who Jesus is. My hope is based on what Jesus did. My hope is based on what Jesus is now doing for me. My hope. Praise the name of the Lord. The counteracting principles of this spiritually dead world church has the morally corrosive powers to eat away at your hope. But God permanently positions and posts the powers of his grace all around your living hope to ensure your confident expectation of Christ. You know how it is. When things start closing in on you, you begin to wonder, is this stuff real? When things start eating away at your resolve, you sometimes wonder, should I still continue down this road? That's when your Lord and Savior will step in and encourage you to go on just a little while longer. Am I right about it? In this present life, until you one day you'll enter finally and fully into salvation, that is eternal life. We have a glimpse of glory divine. But one of these days, we will know just like we are known. Am I right about it? Palm Sunday reminds us of and represents our hope in Jesus Christ, where he turns tragedy into triumph. Am I right? He's riding on that road toward Jerusalem that day. They shouted loudly, Hosanna. What hope they had that he is the Christ. And even though we may have heaviness heaped upon us in this life, in this spiritually dead world, we can be reminded on days like this that we have hope. And I don't know about anybody else, but my hope is not dead. My hope is alive. I wouldn't keep coming here today if my hope wasn't alive. I'd go find something else to do. Am I right? But because I know that Jesus is alive, I have hope. Let me say it like I feel it. I got hope all over the place. Hallelujah, somebody. When it's rough in my life, I have hope. When it's good in my life, I have hope. When it's rough, I have hope. When it's smooth, I just got hope all over the place. And the effect of your hope is expressed best during the worst. Trust that God keeps you in the midst of all trying situations. Hallelujah, somebody. It's easy to have hope when things are going well. But your hope is really tested when things are not going so well. Am I right about it? My love is proven in my marriage when things weren't going so well. Because you stick and you stay. Am I right about it? Hallelujah, somebody. It's all right when everything is hunky-dory. But what about when things start going south and going sour? Can you still have that hope in Jesus Christ? There are some of you sitting here this morning with a hangdog look, just feeling bad. You don't know my story. You don't know my story. But the story I'm going to tell you is that Jesus is my hope. And I'm going to keep on hoping. Oh, all the way to my grave. And I know that one day, though I die, yet shall I live again. And all along my life's journey, I know my God is with me. I'm not a foolish man. I'm not one who is superstitious. I have a real relationship with my God. I know Jesus is real today. I suggest you try him for yourself. And I don't mean an intellectual assent. I mean something that really happens inside of you. Trust that God keeps you in the midst of all trying situations. Those who had been scattered about in Asia Minor, they were being persecuted generally by the Roman government. But then when they went to certain places, the locals there thought they'd just join in and they'd persecute the Christians too. And so they were in trouble wherever they went. But they held on to their hope in Jesus Christ, knowing that Jesus is real. Now, we have an alarm system on our house. I'm sure most of us do, if not all of us. And we trust that that alarm system will guard all of our possessions. The system affords us the opportunity to go and stay away as long as we choose. Am I right about it? With the hope, that confident expectation that when we return, everything will be all right. Every time I leave the house, I arm the alarm. And I do so with the hope that it will guard my possessions until I return. And when I return, I don't expect anybody to have been in my house because I believe the alarm will frighten them away. Hallelujah, somebody. God set the alarm over 2,000 years ago. Hallelujah, somebody. In Jesus Christ. Praise the name of the Lord. Jesus came and he ministered in Galilee with his life. And he gave his life for the sins of the world. He died on Calvary's cross. Hallelujah, somebody. It's something about that blood of Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. When that blood is covering you, Satan can't really bother you. He might scare you, but he can't touch you because you're covered. God set the alarm over 2,000 years ago. Hanging out on Calvary was my alarm system. He died on Calvary's cross. He was entombed in a borrowed tomb. But on that third day morning, he arose with all power in heaven and earth in his hands. But he went away into heaven. But the alarm is still set. Just because he went away doesn't mean the thief can break in and take you. Hallelujah, somebody. He went away into heaven. And one of these old days, Jesus will return. And he will return finding everything to be all right. He's coming back after a church without a spot, without a wrinkle, because he can keep you until you get home. Trust in the Lord and doubt him not. Lean not to your own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledge him, and he will direct your path. Hallelujah, somebody. And he's coming back to take us where he has gone. Some folk don't believe in heaven. Some folk don't believe a whole lot of stuff, but I believe in the inerrancy of God's word. I believe it is true. And I have hope and I trust all that God has said and done. And I will continue. For I walk by faith and not by sight. I don't go according to my intellectual sagacity, but I go according to my faith in Jesus Christ. For he knows the way. Trust him, church. Keep hope alive. Say that with me. Keep hope alive. Praise the name of the Lord. We're living in some terrible times. The Christian church is being attacked all over the face of this planet. And the Christian faith is being scrutinized, even by folk in the church. So keep hope alive. That's that favorable and confident expectation. I expect it. And I'm fixed and firm in what I expect, because I have a relationship with him. And I know, amen. Early in my Christian walk, there are many things I just believed. But I have lived long enough and had enough experiences. There are some things I know. Hallelujah, somebody. There are things I know. And you can't know it if you don't have a relationship with him. Amen. 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 The invitation to Christ is now extended to any and all. If you don't know him in the pardon of your sin, this is an opportunity for you to give your life to Christ. The Bible says, come without money. Come without price. Come just as you are. Oftentimes we say, well, you know, I have to go get myself ready, and then I can come. Well, if that were the case, if you could get yourself ready, you don't need Jesus Christ. He makes us ready. So what must I do? You need to believe in your heart, your innermost being, the center of your existence. Believe in your heart. Confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, that God has raised him from the dead, and you shall be saved. For it is with the heart that you believe unto righteousness, and it is with the mouth that confession is made unto salvation. See, the heart is that ground that Satan took over in the garden. And the heart is that ground that Christ regains because of his redemptive work upon the cross and his resurrection. Believe in your heart. Confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, that God has raised him from the dead, and you shall be saved. It's with the heart that you believe unto righteousness. It is with your mouth that confession is made unto salvation. Will you come today, whether here or virtually. If you're viewing us and you want to make that step, you can call us at area code 314-421-5288. Leave your name, your number, and a brief message, and someone will get with you to help you make that initial step. It begins with one step, and it's a step of faith. Amen. Faith is the substance of things hoped for. It means it's the confidence, the ground of the things I expect. It's the proof of things that we cannot see. It's the substance of things hoped for. It's the evidence of things that we cannot see. It's the proof, because you have that faith. It means that something has happened to you. For faith cometh by hearing, hearing unto salvation. It comes by hearing, and that hearing by the word of God. God, His Word, and His Holy Spirit together can win the willing heart. Give your life to Him today. If you're tired of going the way you've been going, there's another way. It's the way Christ, it's the Christian way. Come to Him. I know you're tired of living the way you've been living, doing what you have been doing, tripping and falling, starting and stopping. I remember a man gave his son one day an analogy. He told his son, "This is how you are." He said, "Like a jet plane. And it takes off and goes up, lands, takes off, goes up, land, never getting up to where it's supposed to be. Never getting there." He says, "Son, you need to take off, go up, and level off, and fly." Don't you want your life to be like that? Stop burning up all your fuel, starting and stopping. Start living the abundant life. Come to Him today. Come. I came to Him well over 4 decades ago. I didn't come as a kid, not as a teenager, but as a grown man that'd been through a little something. I was married. My wife was pregnant with our first child. And I kept hearing somebody talking about Jesus. And more than 4 decades, almost 5 decades now later, I'm here. I recommend Jesus. I recommend Him to one and all. Father, we have done Your will, and we find it to be marvelous in our sight. And dear Master, we pray that You'll bless that one who is trying to make a decision about Christ. Father, I pray that as they open their hearts to You, that You will assist them in making that initial step, for they desire to make that step. And Father, with You there, with Your aid, with Your grace, they can make that step in faith. Bless them now. Strengthen them now. Dear Father, Please, Holy Father. And Father, we thank you for your wonderful word that always shows us your will. Thank you for your word that we find to always be both lamp and light. In Jesus' name and for his sake we say, amen, 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 amen. Now, church, as we are about to leave this place, but never the Lord's presence, we will do so in this fashion. And once again, to all of you, very, very beautiful Palm Sunday to everyone. Until we meet again. The grace of Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide with all of us henceforth, now, and forevermore. Let every believing soul say, Amen. Amen. God bless you, church, and go in peace, go in peace, go in peace.